Today, we're going to get a preview of the online cannabis store the province is running. It's called OCS. That's where, starting Wednesday, you'll be able to buy recreational pot once it is officially legal. Now, with that, Toronto's police chief has made it clear to his members they are not to have ingested any form of cannabis within 28 days of reporting for work. This news just coming in this last couple days. Chief Mark Saunders joins me now. Thank you so much for coming in.
How are you?
Good. I know it's been a busy prep time for your force. Yeah. Let's get right back to that 28-day rule, which was just released by yourself in the last week. Different cities have different rules right now. So Montreal, Vancouver are saying recreational pot for off-duty officers, no problem. Why is Toronto different?
Well, we're not all the same. Everyone is different. I'm not the only agency that's saying 28 days. There are more that have 28 days, and there's some that just say zero tolerance. And what we did is we've been looking at this for over a year and a half, and when we look at the research, the science is telling us that THC will store in the body longer than alcohol. So to compare alcohol to THC is just incorrect. And when we talk about chronic usage, it can be stored in the body for weeks. So my concern is if I've got to make a choice between recreational usage versus safety, I'll always err towards safety. Safety for the community and equally safety for the men and women on the service. We're asking them to do things and make decisions in nanoseconds. When we talk about interfering with psychomotor skills, I have a concern for that. But I've left things open-ended and I've said very clear in the segments of what's being put out there, if you listen to the whole thing, I'm open to having a conversation, and if there's science that proves different numbers, different findings, mm-hmm. I want those numbers to be put to me. I want those findings to be put to me so I can move forward to figure out what is the proper baseline for where we need to go. But I'll err on the side of caution right now and understanding our city, my men and women, do the most police work out of any other city in the country.
Mm-hmm. It's fair. And there's going to be a lot of gray over the next little while. When we talk about enforcement, we know it's the dragger drug test 5,000. And some cities have said, there's no way. We are not using this. This is not reliable. What are the tools that Toronto Police have in your toolbox right now for enforcement?
Right now for the driving impaired, we've been doing this for years. So this is not October 17th, and this is brand new. This is not brand new. We have successfully charged and convicted quite a few people for being impaired under the influence of a drug, and THC is included in that. We have increased our numbers of drug recognition evaluators. We have increased our standardized field sobriety testers. Those are two that are critical for that. So we will still have 24 hours a day, 7 days a week coverage of those officers out there on the road to ensure that when it comes to that aspect of policing, we have resources there. We're going to increase those numbers. So right now we have 320 of the standardized field sobriety testers, and we have 19 of the drug, the DREs. And that is going to grow. And we are going to evaluate. We're going to be looking at patterns and trends, look at the increases. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to get subjective because people are going, it is going to increase. Let's see what the numbers are going to show us, but also anticipate that there might be an increase, come back, reevaluate, and see where we go from there.
What does that test physically look like, Chief? So you know, when someone is believed to be impaired via alcohol, they blow into something. What about when they're impaired via a drug? How does someone judge?
Well, it is incredibly complex. I can tell you that right now. You have to be an expert. So the standardized field sobriety testers are the first layer that go through. And when through their testing, they're able to make a determination. And from that determination, you can then make the apprehension and then make the demand to go to the drug recognition expert. That recognition expert then goes through a very methodical, very intense, very science-based process to formulate whether or not that person will be charged criminally or will make the determination and nullify what the standardized field sobriety test says. It says, no, this person does not hit that benchmark. So there is no guarantee that when you go through these layers, you're going to walk out being charged.
Right.
And then at the end of the day, what we've been doing is using urine and then using that, the science piece, to go before the courts to make that determination for a conviction.
Gotcha. Come October 7th, I know everything's not going to change completely October 17th. You've already been working on this. Will there be, though, additional layers of you'll see more people out and about watching for it, more officers?
Well, the training will increase as time goes on. My bigger concern is the capacity piece. Right now, 911 is getting overused. Mm-hmm. We have people calling in to ask for directions. We have people calling in to say, I've lost my phone. Can you please dial this number? It's ridiculous. 911, it is for life-saving issues. My concern now, when we do on October 17th, it is legal. My concern is that we're going to have these inordinately high numbers on 911. Please do not use 911 for the cannabis calls. It is not the place to call. It is for imminent danger and imminent danger only. So that's the starting message we're putting to the public because it's important. It involves life or death. Mm-hmm. But going forward, you will see officers that will be out in the road doing what they normally do. If a person is impaired, understanding impaired is based on your ability to drive. Mm-hmm. So the first thing that an officer will see is a vehicle that is not driving in conduciveness to what they should be doing. That's the first thing. Then they're pulled over. Then they make observations, and based on those observations, it determines whether you move further on that impairment discussion.
Right. Lastly for you, Chief, before I let you go, there are still a number of dispensaries up and running. Many shut down, many pop back up. Is there going to be more enforcement? What is the game plan now with those that are running illegally?
Well, once again, that's not going to change. If you're running an illegal dispensary, then we will make the apprehensions. I'm assuming that there will be the adequate funding. We will have to provide the necessary resources. But at the end of the day, as I've always said, my biggest thing has always been two things. Number one, the danger of ingesting what you don't know. Number two, the black market. Where is it coming from? If it's not coming from the government, then it's coming from another entity. Chances are, black market. You're facilitating and encouraging organized crime. So I've got those concerns. So the enforcement piece will be there. And when we get to that moment, we will make those apprehensions.
All right, Chief, a lot to discuss, and I'm sure we'll have more to discuss post the 17th. Thank you so much for coming in,
okay,
as always. We're going to take a quick break here on Breakfast Television, and we'll see you right after this.